We're given a problem in this chapter, which is, to a human mind, quite insurmountable. If you are flying a kite with a 200-foot string, and there it is up there, wagging around up in the sky, and you're holding on down here, you know very well that you cannot let go if you want that kite. And Joel has given us a kite, and he has told us you can either hold on or let go. It's up to you. He has made certain statements which can be construed as a challenge. And if you have read this chapter, you have read that there is no power in an atom bomb. You have read that your body cannot be sick and it cannot be well. And you have read that there is no power on this earth to make you blind. So you might say, he's given us the kite and the string and put it in our hands, and now what are we going to do about it? Can we hold on? Can we learn something that will take us up to that altitude where we can say, yes, I not only agree, but I have the developed consciousness which can look out at this world just as he does. And I too can say with confidence, there is no power in an atom bomb, there is nothing in this world that can make me blind, and my body can be neither sick nor well. That's the challenge. The moment you try to work it with your mind, you find you're using that quality which cannot meet the challenge and cannot overcome the challenge. It is this very mind which is the target of the challenge. My kingdom is not of this world. Therefore, we have to look at what my kingdom is. And what is this world? And what is the real meaning of this strange phrase? Perhaps the best way to start there is to say, who said it? And you will find a great division of opinion about who said it, because according to the Bible, Jesus said it. And therefore, all teaching on that basis would say that Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. And you will discover that because it is believed that Jesus said it, there has been no illumination about the meaning of the phrase, nor has this world found the kingdom. It cannot find the kingdom of God because it thinks Jesus said it. That isn't the only reason, but it's a very good contributing factor. Now we know that this statement came not from Jesus, but through Jesus. And the distinction is vital. That which spoke the words through Jesus was the Christ of God. And the Christ of God was saying, the Christ kingdom is not of this world. The Christ kingdom is reality. The kingdom of Christ is the kingdom of the Son of God. And therefore, this world is not of the Son of God. The Christ kingdom is power. And therefore, there is no power in this world because this is not the Christ kingdom. And when you know there is no power in this world, then you have no power in this world to fear. Now this begins an understanding which lends itself to very careful analysis. We know that this world, if it is not my Father's kingdom, cannot be reality. And if it is not reality, then it must be a concept. And if it is a concept, then that which conceives it is a liar. And I know that my world is conceived by my senses, and they must be a liar. My sense concept of this world is wrong because this is not the kingdom of God. And yet, the Christ being present, I can never leave thee or forsake thee. I am with thee always, even unto the end of the world. The kingdom of the Christ must equally be present. And therefore, I am looking at a present kingdom of God. I am looking at the Christ kingdom. I am walking in the Christ kingdom, but my senses are unaware of the Christ kingdom. And therefore, my senses form a concept because they are unaware of the reality. And that concept is called this world. All powers, then, that I believe in are only in my concepts, in my concept world. And they have as much power as my senses believe them to have, and no more. Now then, an atom bomb would appear to be power to a human mind. But if it is power and has the power to destroy, then we are also saying that God is not omnipotent. God is not almighty. And so any time that any religion or any church is in fear of an atom bomb, they are declaring that God is not almighty and they are not worshiping God. My kingdom cannot be invaded by an atom bomb. My kingdom cannot be invaded by a disease, by a virus. And so we find that Christ power, which is the power of the kingdom of God, which is omnipotent power, never has to defend itself against any other power. And as long as I must defend myself against another power, I am declaring that I am not in oneness with Christ power, that I am separated from Christ power. And in my separation from Christ power, in my acceptance of other powers against which I must defend, I am stating that I am separated from God. Because Christ and God are one. And if I am separated from Christ power, I am separated from God. And there is my problem. Now when the Christ, through Jesus, tells us, my kingdom is not of this world, that statement is saying this world is hypnotized. This world is not aware of the kingdom of God on earth. And being unaware of the kingdom of God on earth, it is in a state of total hypnosis. For the only reality is the kingdom of God on earth. When I accept hypnosis as the world consciousness, it makes no difference to me if my neighbor makes a statement pro or con anything. It makes no difference to me if my neighbor sees good or evil. It makes no difference to me if my neighbor says there is a hurricane or not. This world and all it contains is a state of hypnosis. And I cannot accept or pretend for a moment that I can receive the truth from any human consciousness. There is no human consciousness on the face of the earth that can give you or me the truth because It is of this world, which is not my Father's kingdom. It is separated from God, and that is why it is a human consciousness. I must look elsewhere for the truth. I must look to the Spirit of God within me. And if I wish to live in the truth, I must look to the Spirit of God in me and in you at all times. Now, we're holding on to that kite. We're not letting go. We must come to the place where the atom bomb to me, the earthquake, the virus, the hurricane, the flood and the fire, today's very problem, whatever it might be, or the conglomeration of all the problems in the world at my doorstep, must be seen as non-power. For God alone is the power. Now let's take blindness and see what that means. The eyes cannot see. The man is blind. But what is preventing him from seeing? Is it God's will that he be blind? And the loud answer comes, no, it is not the Father's will that he be blind. Is there another will on this earth than the Father's will? No, there is not. And if it is not the Father's will that he be blind, how can he be blind? The answer is he cannot be. There is no blindness in God. Oh, but he thinks he is, and he cannot see. That's right, and that's the nature of the hypnosis. Blindness is hypnosis. If blindness is not hypnosis, if it is real, then how can the Father say, "Be ye perfect as your Father which is in heaven"? What meaning would there be to that? And if the Father says, "Be ye perfect," what will is there on this earth that can prevent any individual from being perfect? There is no such will. When the Father, through the Christ in you, addresses you and says, "Be ye perfect," that means this instant you are perfect. And there's nothing can change it. You are perfect as your Father because it is your Father's will that ye be, and therefore you are not blind. But I still cannot see. That is right, you still cannot see. But now apply the principle. The Father says, "Be perfect." That means have my vision. In this particular case of blindness, that can be translated to mean have my perfect vision. If it were deafness, it would be have my perfect hearing. If it were anything that was of a nature to be a problem, it would be have my perfect so-and-so. This is the meaning of be ye perfect, and not tomorrow. Now are we the sons of God. And therefore, be ye in a perfect state of vision, because I, the Father, can never leave thee. I am with thee now, and my vision is perfect, and we are one. Therefore, my perfect vision is where you are. Where is it? The place whereon thou standest is holy ground, and therefore my vision is right on the ground where you stand. But you are blind, you think. Now, my vision being there, you cannot be blind. You can only be blind to my vision. But my vision is there. You can be deaf to my infinite hearing, but my infinite hearing is there. The perfect quality of the Father is where the blind man stands. And the blind man is blind to that perfect quality. That constitutes his state of hypnosis. Now, is this his belief? Is that where the belief in blindness began? No. We have a universal belief in blindness. We believe there are blind people. And this universal belief in blindness is the universal sense of power. which has as much power over the Christ as an atom bomb would have, or as a crucifixion would have, meaning no power. Therefore, what is missing? The Christ consciousness of the blind man is missing. For in Christ consciousness, the Christ within says, open thine eyes. And so again, we're holding on to our kite. We are coming to a place then where we know that Christ consciousness releases the universal hypnotism of blindness in the one who comes into the Christ consciousness. And so our goal is to become conscious of the Christ where we stand. For it is the Christ which doeth the works, which says, stretch forth thine arm, open thine eyes, sit down and eat, pick up your bed. It is the Christ that commands the fulfillment on earth of the Father's glory which is in heaven. It is the Christ which makes the Word become flesh. Now we are told that all that is a problem on this earth is an image. An image and thought. We are told that there is one mind. And that one mind has within itself its own perfect idea and its own perfect manifestation of that idea. And we know blindness is not in that idea. We also know that we have counterfeit human minds. And that because we have a second mind, we have a second life. A life which is divorced from its own reality. A life which is truly a counterfeit. And because there is a second mind, there are second powers. Because there is a second mind, there is a duality, a separation, and this reflects itself in all that we do. Why, even our own physical appearance. God doesn't have two ears or two eyes. We begin to see that there is a crucifixion ahead of us, a crucifixion of this world, a dissolution of this world. And we recognize that Jesus was here to dissolve this world. If my kingdom is not of this world, and this world is the imitation containing both good and evil, are we to remove the evil and just expect the good? When even the good is an imitation and must deteriorate, even the healthy body must become dead. The dissolution of this world was the mission. And we have been trying to perpetuate it. Now, the dissolution is not to come except through the power of love, the power of Christ, through redemption, through regeneration, through a removal of that which is not. The removal of that which is not is called rebirth. And as each individual is able to step into a place where, through Christ consciousness, that which is not is removed, the ears are opened, the eyes are opened, the fullness of the Christ begins to manifest as individual experience. Now, in a specific case where the blindness is setting in, we find that it is quite possible to change that, and that the changing of that depends on several factors. And because this is so crucial and demands such unceasing work, most of us, unaware of the unceasing work that is necessary, do not apply this principle to our own work. There has to be a consciousness which accepts that there is no will on earth to oppose the perfect will of God. That there is no power to oppose the perfect power of God. And therefore, although the naked senses may continue to bear witness to the world, to the defects, to the imperfections, to the problems, they are doing so because of a power beyond their ability to cope with. And you cannot meet these powers with the power of the senses or with the power of the human mind. This is impossible. To give you an idea of the problem in its magnitude, I'd like you to take a phrase of Joel's and really dig into that phrase and open it up. Now, the phrase is that whatever problem we are encountering is not really a problem. It is a mental image. That means if it's a sore foot or a toothache or a bank account or a cancer or blindness or deafness, name it, whatever it is a mental image. Now, you can't imagine a bomb as a mental image until you start analyzing it. An atom bomb, too, would be classified as a mental image. This world is classified as a mental image. Now then, let's take that word image so that you have a real clear idea of what appears to be the adversary. An image, as we know it, is something we see. But start to take that image apart into its component parts, and you find the image of a footache, for example, is not just what you see. It's composed of many other things. Now, first, there are two kinds of images in the footache. There's the image of sight, the discoloration, the swelling, and there's the image of touch. The way it feels is the image that your mind makes of that feeling. And in the image of touch, there are many different feelings. And in the image of sight, there are many different sights. So let's take the image of sight and watch what happens. You're looking at your swollen foot, and the bridge of it is swollen over. It's concave where it should be convex. It's a little purple here and a little red there. You can see that the size of it is 25% larger than it ought to be. Your mind is weighing it against the shoe you wear. And then the feeling that you can't stand on it, the shooting pains that come out from where the spot is that hurts into other places, the awareness that this is going to jeopardize your activity. All of this is part of the image. Now, this is only what you're aware of. Now let's go into what you're not aware of. What's making that discoloration? You can't see what's causing the discoloration. You cannot see what's causing the swelling. And because you cannot see what's causing this, you cannot know that this is a state of hypnosis, as well as if you could see the actual cause. It's the gap between what you cannot see and what your mind thinks, which often throws you into a state of fear. Now, what is really happening down there? Well, is it God's will that you have a swollen foot? And you know it's not. And if it is not God's will, is it happening? No, it cannot be happening because it's not God's will. But what is happening? The point is that nothing is happening, but you are in dire pain. Now, this image is not an image. It is billions of images. It is image upon image upon image upon image. Just the way little ants will build an anthill. You cannot see what they are dropping on that anthill as much as you can see the result of it growing. And almost imperceptibly, it seems to grow, even though you cannot really see them building it that fast. So it is with this swelling. You are looking at some atomic reaction. Now, what is an atomic reaction? You're looking at something so small, so tiny, that you cannot see it, and yet you are seeing what you cannot see in a way that isn't true. You are looking at an image which goes past your ability to see it so quickly, and then another image which comes right on top of it, and then still another and another and another, until in 1 second, unknown to your mind, you have looked at billions of images in 1 second. Each one just a shade different, so that the total impression of those billions of images, all beneath the level of your awareness, make the little anthill grow. And that is your swelling. And all of this is the reaction of your brain to the radioactivity that you call your foot. Normally, you're looking at the radioactivity which you call your foot, and you don't mind a bit because there's nothing changing in it. It's normal. But now something comes into the atmosphere to disturb that from the universal mind, the false universal mind. That is disturbed, and now the disturbance to you is a terrible thing because your brain reaction is glued to this disturbance and you can't get out of it. These images are moving with the speed of light in a great tiny circle. And while you're looking at them, not aware that they are there, the overall effect to you is a foot swelling. Similarly with pain. The pain is the change in your normal brain reaction to the atoms of the foot, to a new reaction. And this is a severe change, so it's a severe pain. All is the relation of the vibration of your brain to the vibration of the atoms of the foot. And all of this taking place in a universal mind which is not the mind of God. You're helpless. You absolutely are bound within it. And none of it is the kingdom of God. It's this world. But it passes for a foot swelling, or you can take it out of that context and it'll pass for a blindness or a deafness. It is always your brain vibration reacting to the vibration of whatever is the problem. And the problem, of course, ensues from that variance in vibration, or we call it a distortion. Now, as long as you remain there, trying with that brain to figure it out, and not accepting the presence of the Christ, which is immune to all vibration, to all atomic radioactivity, to all appearances, you are fighting something that you cannot win. You are trying to overcome an illusion. You are trying to overcome a mirage. And as far as you can get is to possibly overcome that mirage and turn around and face three more. Now, science does that every day of its life. There's a big article on a healing of a wound in the Scientific American, and it's got all kinds of beautiful pictures. Walt Disney would have been proud to have made them. showing the interior of the cells of the human anatomy, how the wound is healed in three stages. And it says if this is studied carefully, we'll have the clue to how to heal some diseases. Now, it's strange that the Christ doesn't heal that way. The Christ doesn't have to study diagrams, doesn't have to go through the various cellular changes and the little miracles that happen when little white cells and red cells do this and do that. The Christ bypasses all this for one reason. This too is part of the world illusion. This too is part of the hypnosis of the world brain and the individual brain. The blindness is a series of impressions which convince the human mind that it cannot see. And so it cannot. It is in a momentary state of paralysis of thought. Its thought has been frozen to the point where I cannot see is the fact accepted. And all the while, the vision of God is waiting for that which cannot see to come unto me, ye who cannot see, ye who are heavy laden by hypnosis, come unto me, the Christ within. Now, while this swollen foot is a sequence of billions of images per second, it keeps building up like an anthill. And now you've got the anthill, but the images keep coming and piling more and more and more. At this particular instant, there's only one image, but that instant is gone before the instant begins. 186,000 miles per second of images. Now you're living on your memory of what happened a second ago and a second before that. And the repetition of these images and your memory retention of all that has happened in this second and the second before, this becomes an image, but it is composed of these billions and billions and billions of images. And that is why you are instantly brainwashed. In one instant, in just one instant, the equivalent of 10,000 years of brainwashing can occur because of the speed of light. That is why the hypnosis is so complete and we look out at a world instead of my Father's kingdom. The sense of touch is exactly the same, only you get the same problem through a different sense. And so you get the same problem at another level of the problem, through another variety of vibrations, another variety of images. This is the sense of touch. And these sense of touch illusions join with the sense of sight illusions, and you're hemmed in. You're locked. Sometimes it begins to affect your breathing. And other times your voice begins to quiver. And so other senses are drawn into it, and finally you're sense locked. And this becomes what everyone accepts. This becomes the conditioned universe. This becomes cosmic conditioning, cosmic hypnosis. It becomes this world. Because as it happens to you, and you cannot get out of it, within generations it becomes the accepted fact. And now the lie about God becomes a permanent consciousness called the human consciousness. And now that which is of the Creator is lost, and there stands instead a creature, sense-bound. And because what you're conscious of becomes your life, we are conscious of this good and this evil, this blindness, this deafness, this sickness, and this becomes our life. The release from the limitations of human consciousness can only come about when you accept that the kingdom of God is a living, present fact. not a future attainment. The place whereon thou stand is the kingdom of God. When you are ready to fill the gap, to walk the gap between what your naked senses in their state of hypnosis tell you and what the Christ through Jesus tells you, then you must walk a gap between what you see, what you experience, and what you are told is really there. And to walk that gap is the way to Christ consciousness. To walk that gap demands a firmness that is never letting go of the kite. Now, to walk that gap between my experience, which tells me there are blind people and that I may be one of them, sick people, diseased people, dying people, suffering people, crippled people, this is my experience. But I know there was one who was able to say, "What did hinder thee? There is no power on earth to stop you from being perfect as your Father." And therefore, although that is not my experience, I must accept that as the reality that is here and now. And the reality that I cannot see but accept, and the experience that I do see but will not accept, this represents the gap that I'm going to walk. And to walk it, I must never let go of the concept of the presence of God in my consciousness. That awareness that the invisible presence of God is here now can never be let go of, or it's just like letting go of the kite and watching it fly away. If I am determined to hold on to the truth, come what may, I will walk that gap, and the truth will reveal itself, and I will know the truth that I have not yet experienced, and that truth that I know will set me free. Now, I know that God is not blind and God is all, and therefore blindness cannot be real. And though I be blind, I need not be, and I am commanded not to be. I am commanded to be all-seeing. And therefore, I accept the words of my Father. And his words are, "Open thine eyes." What was spoken to one was spoken to all. And therefore, I accept that I now have inner vision. My experience shows me I have no outer vision, but I accept that I have inner vision. This I accept. I also accept that that which is realized within will externalize in the without. I accept that the consciousness of God unfolds as our experience, and that if I can hold to the inner realization that I have inner vision, this must externalize as outer vision. And therefore, I am saying that I do not have outer vision because I have not accepted inner vision. I do not have outer hearing because I have not accepted inner hearing. I have not accepted that I must have these things because God stands on the ground where I stand. We are one. Now, I have seen that as you hold to inner vision, knowing you have inner vision, because all that I have is thine, I have seen that outer vision comes. And this is the only evidence I need to know that it can be done with anyone. I can understand why Christ consciousness can say, "Open thine eyes." Because this is the voice of the Christ within you saying, "Open thine eyes." And that means it is done. There's nothing more to do. It is done. When the Christ within you says, "Open thine eyes," that means vision is there. The Word and the flesh The word and the manifestation, the word and the experience are one. The Christ speaks with tongues. Its present and its future and its past are all now. Now, anyone with any problem whatsoever can take the word of God within themselves, that all that I have is thine. My kingdom is at hand, not in some remote heaven, but in heaven present on earth. My kingdom is where you stand. And therefore, all that I have is thine is present in my kingdom where you stand. And you have all that I have now. Your function is to accept it. To accept it in such a way that in the acceptance, you know you have it within yourself, and this is the truth. And then, come what may, in the outer of your experience, knowing that the senses are hypnotized, that universal belief is as strong as the power of gravity on earth, but is still only a mortal mind experience, you know that your experience will bear the lie to this truth for quite a time, because you're pushing out against the gravity of world thought. But you have the power of the Father to sustain you, to release you, to teach you, to guide you, to show you, to finally liberate you. And you must make that stand, because that is walking the gap. When you walk that gap, when you make that stand, you are accepting the Father, you are obedient unto the Father, meek unto the Father, and you will show forth that truth which you have accepted, because whatever is accepted within and is true must show forth in the external. You see then that the final demonstration of God in you cannot occur until you have taken hold of that oneness which God says is yours. That's your kite, and you must hold it. You must walk through many a dark night of the soul, holding on to that oneness if you have nothing else. Without oneness, there must be division. And in division, you lose. You lose the fullness which opens the eyes, which opens the ears. Now, we have had many opportunities to do this, but we have never really been faced with the fact that it is not going to do itself. I was quite surprised. I shouldn't have been, but I read an article by a famous evangelist in the paper the other day. Somebody came to the house to see me and brought it with him. And this evangelist said, I have it here. This is what we face. I can hardly see it. Well, I can't see it. It says that I expect, every night I go to bed, I expect that the Christ will come the next day. And when I wake up the next day, I expect the Christ will come if he hasn't come already. Now, this sounds like such a holy statement, but it's complete ignorance of the nature of the Christ. 20,000 people heard that in Madison Square Garden. And I'm sure that 100,000 more will hear it, and several hundred thousand more will read it, all being excited about the second coming of the Christ. There's no second coming of the Christ. If the Christ is going to come again, then there's no meaning in the words, I can never leave thee or forsake thee. I am with thee always. Now, this man is an expert on the Bible. But I am with thee always doesn't mean that the Christ is with you always to him. It means that Christ is going to come back sometime. And don't you see that this is the very nature of the hypnotism which keeps us in a sense of separation from the very thing we are seeking to liberate us from the hypnosis? The only thing that can liberate you is the Christ. And if you're waiting for it, you can wait another 2,000 years. You can wait 1,000,000 years. But once you say, the Christ has never left me, then all of the powers of the world are non-power. For the Christ is the only power, and it is right where the world sees me. Thou seest me, thou seest the Father. Thou seest the Son of the Father. Thou seest the Christ. Waiting for the Christ tomorrow? What a long wait that will be. Now is the Christ. Now are we the sons of God. Here is the Christ. This minute is the Christ. And that is the kite you hold on to. Never am I separated from the Christ. For the Christ is the Son of God that I am. There is your power. There is your release from blindness, from deafness, from hunger, from starvation, from famine, from earthquake, and from flood. That is what you must hold on to, come whatever comes. And hanging on to that, you discover that these things which are called powers are only a power to one who is not aware that that which is the Christ is the substance of his own being. That is why there are many powers in a world which pretends that God is almighty and still clings to many, many powers, while out of one corner of its mouth saying God is the almighty. Now there is only one power, and because there is only one power,
in the infinite way, you never seek a power to overcome a power.